Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present The Lost Heiress by Roseanna M. White. Narrated by Liz Pearce. Chapter 1. Monte Carlo, Monaco. Late August, 1910. Temptation sat before her, compelling as the sea. Gleaming silver, green leather, the nearly silent rumble of engine. Brook trailed a gloved hand along the door, cast one glance over her shoulder, and let herself in. She couldn't stop the grin as she gripped the wheel of the Rolls-Royce. And why should she? Only a fool would leave such a car running right outside her door and not expect her to do something about it.
Don't even think it.
His voice brought laughter to her lips, and she looked up to find her dearest friend at the opposite door, her first sight of him in 5 months. The warm Riviera wind had tousled his hair, making her wonder where his hat had gone today.
Teach me to drive it, Justin.
He glared at her with an intensity to match the Mediterranean sun. All manner of men flooded Monaco in pursuit of its casino, and none could glower like the British. Well, perhaps the Russians, but theirs was more scowls than proper glowers. Though, if he expected her to be cowed by the look, he had taken leave of his senses. He levelled an accusatory finger at her nose.
I'm happy to take you for a drive in my new car, mon ami, but I will be behind the wheel.
Come, Justin.
She said his name as it was meant to be said, in French. Soft J and long U, emphasis on the second syllable, the N silent, as she knew no one in his native country did.
Your gift will soon be back in England. We mustn't waste a moment of its time in Monaco. Get in and teach me.
A moment of its time?
But he laughed and slid into the left side of the car, shaking his head. The sun caught his hair and burnished it gold, caught the angles of his face and made it all the stronger.
The prince will have my head for this.
Brooke grinned at him. Once upon a time, she had dreamed that they would fall in love and live happily ever after. Before, she realized a future duke could never be more than friends with a nobody without a past. Before she came to understand, Prince Albert wasn't really her grandfather.
He will be jealous, you mean? He must always have a chauffeur behind the wheel.
Brooke gripped the wheel tighter until she could feel the thrum of the 40-50 engine in every cell.
Perhaps I will borrow one of the chauffeur's jackets and surprise him one day, after you've taught me.
Justin pressed a hand to his brow, dark blonde hair falling over his fingers.
Heaven help me, I'll be executed. My poor grandfather will expire from the shock of it. The dukedom will go extinct, and it will be all your fault. All because you grin at me and I can't say no.
She grinned all the brighter now.
I don't intend to race in Grandpère's road rally. I only want to learn the basics.
She made herself comfortable on the seat, positioning her feet on the pedals on either side of the steering column. She had read books and articles about the advances of the automobile, but the pages hadn't come close to conveying the power that came coursing through the floorboard. It was almost as heady a feeling as having a spirited horse under her. Almost. Justin slid closer, casting her a sideways look she couldn't read, making fear knot in her chest. She'd been waiting months for him to return, had begun to worry he never would, that his family would succeed in keeping him forever in the Cotswolds of England, and he would forget his promises to investigate the seal on the old yellowed envelope she had pressed to his palm 5 months ago. She cleared her throat.
Did you learn anything in England, I mean?
Justin adjusted the position of her hands on the wheel.
Of course I did. Literature and mathematics.
Justin Wilden.
Philosophy and science.
He ducked his head as if to make sure her feet were where they ought to be, or to avoid her gaze. I came across the papers of a German not long ago, fellow by the name of Albert Einstein, a physics professor. Have you read him? He has interesting theories.
Lord Harlow.
She narrowed her eyes at him, but he still didn't look up. About Newtonian physics and something called special relativity, which I know you'd find interesting. He straightened, focus still on her feet. There are pedals for clutch, brake, and accelerator. Throttle is on the steering column. You must press upon brake and clutch to begin.
I know.
She pushed them without taking her eyes off his strong profile. And you know well what I mean. He finally swung his face her way again, jaw set.
We can either talk about that, or you can learn to drive. Choose one, for I don't intend to open such a conversation with you behind the wheel of my very new, very expensive automobile.
Bad as all that, is it?
She prayed again she could live with the answers she'd asked him to find. For 8 years now, she had known only who she wasn't. Not the illegitimate daughter of opera star Colette Sabatini and Prince Louis Grimaldi, heir to the throne of Monaco. Not the petite fille of the reigning Prince Albert, as his wife, Prince Alice, had shouted for all the palace to hear before she left him. So if not a daughter or granddaughter to the only family she knew, then who?
Release the handbrake first of all, there by the wheel on your right.
Drawing in a long breath, she gripped the wooden handle and moved it as she had seen their drivers do, then checked for carriages or cars in the street. Seeing none, she mimicked the pedal work she had observed, moving her foot from the brake and aiming it at the accelerator.
Brook!
Quoi?
She jammed her foot back on the brake. Justin ran a hand over his face.
Attends! Please wait for my instruction.
Another grin tickled her lips and pushed away the phantoms of the unknown.
When have I ever awaited instruction? But did I not let my first arrow fly with admirable accuracy? Am I not a better shot with a pistol than you? Can I not outfence any young lord?
At last, a breath of laughter relaxed his shoulders. Then he caught her gaze and held it, his eyes as deep as the ocean.
You think I don't know the thoughts rampaging through your mind, but I assure you, you've nothing to worry about. The news I bring is good.
He gave her fingers a reassuring squeeze.
But it will change everything. You shouldn't try to digest it when behind the wheel of a car.
She nodded and pushed the questions aside, for now. Now I check the street again and transfer my foot from brake to accelerator while easing off the clutch.
A statement rather than a question, I see.
His fingers left hers as he turned around to look at the street.
All clear. Angle the wheel to the left and gently, gently press that foot to the accelerator.
She obeyed, reveling in the increased thrum of the engine. Easing the car forward, a laugh slipped from her lips. She straightened the wheel and headed for the opera house. She could get the hang of this, given a bit more practice. Perhaps she could even convince Grandpère to let her drive one of theirs. Assuming she remained in Monaco. Risking a glance toward Justin, she barely kept from taking one hand off the wheel to play with the two pearls dangling from the gold filigree of her necklace.
You did verify I'm English, then?
He shot a look at the fingers she had nearly lifted, as if he knew exactly what habit she'd nearly indulged.
We already knew that.
She sighed and let off the accelerator when they came upon a slow-moving barouche.
We knew Maman said so, but she was hardly in her right mind those last weeks.
And for so many years, Brooke had hoped and prayed that that had been the lie, as Grandpère so often assured her.
It was right enough. You are indeed English, which, assuming you've looked in a mirror now and again, oughtn't to surprise you.
Right on cue, the wind cast a tendril of her pale hair before her eyes. She certainly had nothing in common with the rest of the Grimaldis. How many times had she wished for their rich, dark hair and fathomless brown eyes? The skin that sun could kiss yet not burn? A delicate snort was all the response she could manage. Justin loosed a sigh nearly lost under the purr of the engine.
The story seems to be true. She was in York with the opera at the time, but did not have a child of her own.
Had Brooke been anywhere else, she would have let her eyes slide closed so that she could summon the image of beautiful Maman, try to conjure the sound of her sterling soprano. But the memory had faded over the years, until now it was little more than a crystal echo.
So Prince Louis was right to keep me always at a distance. I am not his daughter.
At least she wasn't another cause for scandal in the Grimaldi line. But it also meant Maman was not her mother. And Grandpère, he hadn't wanted her to ask these questions. She was, he had said, the only member of his family who acted like family. And what would he have if she left? But she had to. She couldn't live her life as a pretender. The people were already shouting against him. How much worse it would be if he continued to support her when she had no real claim to him, other than a bone-deep love. The barouche they followed turned down a side road, and Brooke pressed on the accelerator.
What am I, then? A farmer's daughter? An abandoned waif?
His chuckle helped ease the band around her chest.
Mais non. It is as we imagined. You are a nymph from the fairy world. A naiad, you mean, ruling over a brook. How could I have forgotten?
He captured the curl that obscured her vision and gave it a playful tug.
One of my favourites of our recent stories, Brook of the Brook. And where is my fairy princess taking us?
She smiled, but even the thought of the stories they created and picnics atop the ramparts overlooking Port Fontvieille couldn't erase the questions.
The theatre. I have a ballet lesson. I keep threatening to join the ballet russe. Sergei says I am as talented as his Russian dancers.
An imp more than a naiad, surely.
He tugged again on her curl and tucked it behind her ear.
I can only imagine how mad that drives the prince.
It hardly matters what I do.
She slowed as her turn approached and prepared to wrestle the wheel around. Her heart thudded, but she drew in a deep breath. If she slipped, Justin would catch the wheel, would keep them from harm.
You will not take the stage.
Justin sounded far harsher than Grandpère had. Perhaps her tone had been too blasé. Still, she could hardly resist teasing him and fishing for more information.
Excuse me, your lordship, but why not? My mother was on the stage.
Colette would have been the first to tell you not to follow her example. And she was not your mother.
Quite right. I am an orphan and unknown. Lisette Brook, a nobody.
You most certainly are not.
Who am I, then?
She glanced his way, brows arched.
Eyes on the road.
Hopefully he saw only that she turned her face square to the windscreen, and not that she rolled her eyes in the process.
Was I right about the envelope, the seal?
Maman had left her with boxes upon boxes of correspondence, faded letters from faded loves. But one box of them had been different. They were in English. The tone was different, too. Not at all what amorous patrons had usually sent to Colette. And more, as she searched through the letters, in the flat she'd shared with Maman before moving to the palace after her death, Brooke had seen a variation of her own name on the ones on top of the stack.
Give little Liz a kiss from her papa.
But it had been signed only with yours forever. And the one envelope with the seal upon it had no address. Yet again she had to resist the urge to touch her necklace. The necklace Maman had confessed with her last breath had belonged to Brooke's true mother. The woman killed in the carriage accident from which Colette had rescued Brooke.
The my love those English letters were written to? The seal was helpful, Brooke.
He sighed again and rested a hand on her shoulder.
It led me to your mother. I saw a portrait of her, and it might as well have been you in a bustle.
We found her. We found you. Her fingers curled around the wheel so tightly she feared she'd leave an impression in the wood.
Who then? Who am I?
We're nearly to the theatre. Pull over here. Foot off the gas, press the brake and then the clutch. Turn, turn.
His fingers covered hers as he helped her guide the Rolls-Royce into an open spot nearer the casino than the theatre. The moment the car halted, he reached over her to engage the handbrake and then switched off the magneto. The absence of the engine's noise barely made a difference with all the chatter from the street. But Brooke didn't look at the gaily clad aristocrats making their way into the Casino Monte Carlo. She looked at the muscle gone tense in his jaw.
Justin.
Her voice came out in a whisper, so soft she couldn't be sure he heard her.
Tell me.
He leaned against the green leather of the seat, elbow atop it, and rested his hand on her shoulder again.
You are a baroness.
A what?
She knew the title. One couldn't be the friend of a duke's grandson without getting lessons in the British peerage. Which was why she knew she shouldn't have such a title, unless by marriage.
How could I be a baroness?
The wind tried to toss that curl into her face again, but he caught it and tucked it away once more.
From your mother, who was a baroness in her own right, passed from her mother and her mother before her. You are Elizabeth Brooke Eden, Baroness of Berkeley, one of only a handful of peeresses whose title is by right and not courtesy, and the heiress to a large estate.
Little Liz.
Maman had kept her name, just made it more French. Lisette Brooke. Choosing to go by her middle name after Colette's death had been one of Brooke's many small rebellions. Her eyes slid shut. Her fingers found the warm pearls dangling from her necklace. Her mother's necklace. Her mother.
What was her name?
Elizabeth as well, born with the surname Brooke, which is where your middle name came from, Countess of Whitby.
Countess?
Her eyes flew open again. My father was an earl? Justin's free hand found hers, and he linked their fingers together. Is an earl, Brooklet. Had she been standing, she would have had to sit.
My father?
Is very eager to meet you. He squeezed her hand and ran his thumb over hers. It's time to come home, Lady Berkeley. Brooke drew in a long breath, seasoned with fruit from the markets, the spice of Italian cooking, and the salty tang of the Mediterranean Sea. All her life, all her memory, this had been her home. All the world she'd needed. I must absorb all this.
Of course you must.
He lifted her hand and kissed her knuckles, as he had done ever since they played knight and damsel as children, back when she had dreamed it was real. But his eyes remained locked on hers now.
I know you have been praying about this as much as I have been. This is the answer to those prayers, mon ami. This is where the Lord wants you, and I will be with you every step of the way.
No doubt he was right, and no doubt when her thoughts stopped crashing like waves in a tempest, the peace of the Lord would descend. But right this moment, I must go. Au revoir, Justin. She leaned over, kissed him on either cheek, and let herself out of the car. A warm breeze gusted up the street. Brooke touched her hat to make sure it was secure, then let her fingers fall to her necklace. A baroness, daughter of an earl. Of all the scenarios she had entertained, that had never been one of them. Chapter 2. Justin was probably the only man in all of Monaco who dreaded crossing the threshold of the famed Casino Monte Carlo. He'd done so enough that the opulence had no effect. The reliefs didn't turn his head, the paintings didn't draw his eye, and the crystal chandeliers were nothing but light for his feet. He could be thankful they had made their home here in Monte Carlo because of Brooke, but still he wished his father would find a different life. Perhaps if he lost more, he would. But no, father had made a fortune at the tables over the years. It was hard to convince a successful gambler to turn over a new leaf when he could turn up a new card instead. Justin paused at the doorway of the baccarat room. Yes, there he was. A debonair smile upon his face, an impeccable suit on his lean figure, a pretty girl beside him. Drawing in a long breath, Justin closed his eyes for a moment, prayed for the millionth time that day alone for the strength to have the needed conversation. Again, prayed that this time father would hear him. When he opened his eyes, he saw his father toss back the contents of his snifter, cognac, no doubt, and stand. He wobbled a bit as he straightened his jacket, but he was smiling. Blast! It may have been easier to convince him to return to England had he been fresh from a loss rather than a win. Father's smile grew when he spotted Justin, and he shook off the woman who had tried to tuck her hand into his arm.
There you are, Justin. Have you been out enjoying your birthday gift? Your Brook saw it the other week when it arrived and assured me it would suit you.
How could he help but grin? Not just at the thought of his new Rolls-Royce, but at the man who had given it. Father had his faults, and twice the charm to offset them.
It is a magnificent car, thank you.
Good, good.
When near enough, his father clapped a hand to Justin's shoulder and steered him toward one of the washrooms.
I considered one designed by that Bugatti chap, but knew you would appreciate the English touch.
Indeed. And it was as good an opening as any. Speaking of things English...
Save your breath, my son. I'm not going back.
A footman bowed as he opened the washroom door for them.
Good evening, Lord William.
Pierre?
While Father moved to the mirror, Justin sighed and sat on a plush chair.
Your refusal to come home doesn't change facts. Uncle Edward has been dead for 12 years. You are not Lord William any more. You are the Marquis of Abingdon, the heir, and will be the next Duke of Stafford. And facts don't change reality.
Father undid his tie and started the knot afresh.
I have no interest in the duchy. When the old man kicks off, the title may come to me by law, but you'll manage the estate perfectly well without my help.
Justin passed a hand over his hair. What had he done with his hat? He must have left it at the palace when he called on Prince Albert earlier. He wants to see you. He isn't well, Father. It's time to make your peace. Father's reflected eyes met his in the mirror. One more tug on the tie and it was in a perfect bow. He turned, faced Justin.
There is no peace to be made.
But if you only...
Don't ask it.
Father sighed and his face softened.
It's for the best. You will make the better duke, be the better overseer of the estate. If I tried to put my hand to it, I would foul it up.
Justin stood again.
Nonsense. If you hadn't an innate sense of how to manage things, you wouldn't do so well here.
Though he had to admit he was glad he took after his Uncle Edward, and not so glad his cousin Caton, his father's sister's son, seemed to take after Father. Chuckling, the Marquess headed toward the casino floor once again, then shifted tack and made for the front doors.
Knowing when to fold a hand and when to bet is a far cry from dealing with tenants and whatnot. As you ought to know, being excellent at the latter, but an absolute dunce at cards.
One corner of Justin's mouth tugged up, even as he fought down the desire to claim he could be good if he tried. An experiment he had sworn to himself he would never perform.
Call it lack of interest.
Though his smile remained bright, a shadow flitted through Father's eyes.
I suppose I ought to be glad I scared you onto the straight and narrow, but there are worse lives than the one I have chosen. You ought to toss responsibility to the wind and indulge yourself for once. Set up your singer's daughter as your mistress and... Oh, for I will not make a mistress of Brook or anyone else.
And why must they have this conversation in public, no less? Another footman opened the main doors and handed Father's hat to him. Obviously, the employees knew the man's comings and goings far better than Justin did. With a shake of his head, he stepped out into the warmth of the evening. The sun was setting behind the mountains to the west, dusting the city with gold. Mischief had entered Father's eyes again.
Why must you always be so pious? I've seen how you've begun looking at her, and it's no wonder. She's grown into a beautiful young thing, but you can't wed her. One so set on doing right by his ducal grandfather would never disgrace the family name by marrying a performer's daughter.
Justin tried clenching his jaw to keep from rising to Father's bait, but he couldn't stop himself.
She is more than that, though... Well, she is no princess. She looks no more like Prince Louis than she did her mother.
He followed when Father turned to the right.
Colette wasn't her mother. Brooke is English. A baroness, as it happens. That brought Father's feet to a halt and his brows up. Really? Well then, I suppose you can wed her. Do it here, will you, before you leave again? I don't fancy having to travel through the dratted English rain for your wedding.
There was no reasoning with him. Why did he try? Justin shook his head as they started forward again.
Who said anything about marrying her? Well, you can't make a mistress of her. She's a baroness.
A snort of laughter slipped out.
Where are you going? Shall we have a meal together?
Not tonight, I'm afraid, though I wish you had made it home for your birthday. I had a regular gala planned out.
Father tipped his hat to a couple strolling toward the casino.
25 now. Your grandfather must be hounding you to marry soon and be about the business of heirs, chanting nonsense about duty.
Regardless of his denial a moment ago, only one face ever came to mind when he considered a wife. But she never looked at him as anything but an old friend. Besides, Brook would have many changes to work through in the near future.
But he knows I have my hands full with learning the estates, and I will have to see Brook settled with the Earl of Whitby, besides. Here we are!
Father halted before a gleaming roadster and rested his hand on the bonnet. Apparently, he had bought a car by that Bugatti chap after all.
The Earl of Whitby, you say?
Justin couldn't help but take a moment to admire the artistry of the lines.
Indeed. Do you know him? I used to.
Father's voice went musing.
I heard he got rather eccentric after the death of his wife and the disappearance of his... Wait, your Brooke is his missing daughter? How the devil did she end up with Colette Sabatini and here of all places? Colette was in Yorkshire at the time. She came upon the carriage accident, though why she brought her here is a mystery.
Justin frowned when Father got into the car.
Surely you don't mean to drive when you've been drinking. A car isn't a horse. It can't find its own way when you keel over in a stupor.
Yet he tossed his hat to the seat and put on goggles and a cap.
You are my son, Justin, not my nursemaid. I am fine. And going to France to keep a dinner engagement. Your bed ought to be made up in the flat, and Fitzroy knows not to expect me. Father, I will be home by luncheon tomorrow.
He flashed a smile, all gleaming white teeth and charming irresponsibility.
Go and find yourself some trouble. It'll do you a world of good.
Once more, Justin had to shake his head. One of these days, we're going to finish a conversation without you riding off on some new lark.
Anything's possible, I suppose.
The engine sprang to life with a roar and a rattle, and Father gave him a jaunty wave before backing out into the street without even looking behind him. Justin pressed a hand to his temple. He ought to go fetch his hat. After he walked off his hope and frustration. Grandpère found her on the ramparts. Brooke's muscles were still warm and fluid from her ballet lesson, making her feel that if she stretched high enough, she could touch the clouds scuttling over the sky, or reach out and skim her hands through the warm waters. She grinned at him, but the prince's returning smile was small and tight. In his hands, he clutched a worn leather book. Her chest went tight. Her relaxation vanished. Her fingers pressed into the warm white stone.
You've spoken to Justin.
Before he found you.
Grandpère didn't stop until he had pulled her tight to his chest and wrapped his arms around her. He smelled of security, ink and paper and a whiff of cologne.
I asked you to let it drop, ma fifi, to be content here with me.
She squeezed her eyes shut against the familiar worsted wool of his favourite jacket.
Grandpère, If it were only us, I would, you know that. I love you more than anything else in the world. But with the people rioting...
That had nothing to do with you. They want a constitution, that's all.
It wasn't all. They all knew it wasn't all. She held him tighter.
Prince Louis was right all along. I'm not his. Charlotte clearly is. She is where your hope lies. Adopt her to keep the Grimaldi line going. Get to know her. Love her.
Brook had never even met Charlotte, the illegitimate daughter with another performer. The daughter Prince Louis actually claimed as his own. But for a few years after the girl's birth, before Colette's deathbed confession, Brook had believed the child was her half-sister.
You should never have taken me in after Maman.
Hush!
He pressed his lips to the top of her head.
You are my petite fille. Whatever your blood, that will not change, and I wish you would stay.
Grandpère.
Je sais, I know you will go. You are too headstrong to listen to your old grandfather when you have made up your mind.
He pulled away, revealing a sad, proud smile. Touching a finger under her chin with one hand, he held up the book in his other.
You should have this, then. I promised Colette I would destroy it, so you would never find it, but I couldn't. I think I always knew you would not be happy here forever. Not when there were questions out there in need of answers. It is her journal.
Brooke's brows knit.
Whose? Maman's? Or my real mother's?
Colette's.
Though he pressed the journal to her hands, he held it still, held it shut.
Whatever answers it has, she thought they would hurt you. There must be a reason for that. Don't open this until you are ready to know what that reason is.
Mutely, she nodded. Her fingers registered the worn leather, tried to feel what secrets might lie within. Part of her wanted to open it immediately, heedless of the warning, and learn what truth she could. But then she glanced up into Grandpère's troubled dark eyes and lowered the book to her side. She couldn't hurt him like that. It would be tantamount to shouting that all he'd given her, all he'd given up for her, meant nothing.
I will wait, Grandpère.
Relief softened his eyes and he nodded.
Come inside, ma fifi. Dress for dinner and then play for me. Let me hear you sing again before you leave me.
Tucking her arm into the crook of his elbow, Brooke let him lead her from the ramparts. Secrets could wait. An hour turned to two. Justin let the warm breeze soothe him, let the mixed scents of sweet and spice remind him of a childhood spent racing through these very streets. He had found trouble aplenty, adventure and happiness too. And Brooke. He had found Brooke on one of those unsupervised sprees. She had been but a sprite of a girl then, only 5 to his 12, but the mischief in her eyes had intrigued him. Fate had said it was strange that he had found such a steadfast friend in a girl 7 years his junior. But it had never seemed so. At first she had simply amused him, and he had fancied her a sister to replace the one he'd barely known. Then it had been entertaining to teach her all the sports he shouldn't have. And now they had 13 years of shared history. The guards let him pass with no more than a nod, and the footman merely pointed him toward the prince's private library. Once he reached the room, the sweet voice spilling out in an Italian aria brought him to a halt. Odd how much like Colette she sounded, though they shared no blood. Her maman had trained her well.
He leaned into the doorway and saw Brook at the piano, accompanying herself as she sang, while Prince Albert lounged in his favorite chair. Her flaxen curls were twisted into some sort of chignon, an embellished band setting it off. As always, she wore the gold and pearl necklace Colette had said was her mother's. Its twin strands of links and pearls met at the filigree in the center, from which two dangling pearls drew attention downward. Justin forced a swallow. She had grown into a young lady too beautiful for his peace of mind. The notion of courting her had begun to niggle in the last few months, but he knew well she didn't look at him like he had begun to look at her. He would have to convince her. Win her. After she settled with her father at Whitby Park, after she had come to terms with being Baroness of Berkeley, after he was better grounded in his duties in Gloucestershire, then he would try to make her see that they could have so much more than friendship. When she finished the song with a flourish, Justin joined his applause to the prince's. She stood with one of those heart-stopping smiles of hers, aimed his way. Justin! As always, the greeting made him smile. Only his closest family ever used his given name in England, and they never attempted the proper French pronunciation. Bonsoir, mon ami. Your Highness. The prince smiled, but Justin scarcely had time to note it, given that Brooke came his way with her hands extended. He took them in his and leaned down to exchange the customary cheek-kissing, and grinned at the thought of how her English family might react to the French ritual. You look lovely tonight, Brooke. An understatement, but it nevertheless brought a pretty blush to her ivory cheeks.
Merci. It is the new dress.
She released his hands and did a pirouette worthy of the stage.
From Paris, grand-père had it commissioned. I told her she would be the envy of all the ladies in England.
Prince Albert stood with an indulgent smile. Justin didn't miss the sorrow around its edges.
Indeed.
Yet it wasn't the gown that would set her apart. It was her spirit. No other lady he'd met in England laughed with such abandon, moved with such grace, put such passion into her every pursuit. He prayed that spirit and the faith beneath it would be enough to sustain her through the transition ahead. As if the same thought had possessed her, her smile dimmed, as did the diamond gleam in her emerald eyes.
You'll join us for dinner, oui?
I would be delighted.
For now, he led her to the settee and took the cushion beside her.
Has it sunk in yet?
Her fingers toyed with the jewel pearls dangling from her necklace, if there were a surer sign of her perplexity.
What if I am not this baroness? What if they turn me away?
The prince huffed.
That is simple. Then you will come home.
He came to them and sat on the settee, resting a hand on Brooke's shoulders. He had fought for her, fought to move her into the palace after Colette's death, though the rest of the family thought it a mistake. Because by then, Brooke had already been his Fifi, his little girl. Prince Albert would always be her grandfather. Although, even if she were not the Baroness, Justin had no intentions of bringing her back to Monaco. He would convince her to stay, somehow or another. The thought of not seeing her for years wasn't to be borne.
We are not mistaken, Brooklet. Had I not been sure about this, I would never have said anything.
But
there is no reason to doubt, and every reason to believe this is who you are.
He held out his hand until she put hers in it, then covered her slender fingers with his.
You have a father eager to love you, an aunt to usher you into society,
cousins near you in age, waiting to become your friends. The Lord has prepared your place. There is no need to fear. He could see the trust returning to her eyes, the sparkle that brought light to the flecks of amber around her pupils, to the rings of sapphire around the emerald. His chest went tight. What would it be like to gaze into her eyes every day? To hear her laugh, her voice, to share stories whenever they pleased. To have the right to draw her into his arms and see if her lips were as soft as they looked. Maybe he wouldn't wait to declare himself. Maybe he could win her heart now and deliver her to Whitby as his fiancée, and use the wedding to lure father home. Hurried footsteps intruded, startling enough to warrant the frown on the prince's face. When a footman charged into the room, the look of horror he wore brought Justin to his feet, Brook along with him. If some crisis of state were about to be announced, and with the revolt of a few months ago still fresh in their memories, he wouldn't discount it. He would take his leave so the prince could attend to business. But the servant looked to him.
"Excusez-moi, Lord Harlow. Forgive me for bringing such news, my lord, but... your father, there has been an accident on the mountain road."
His fingers went lax within Brooke's tightened grip. Clouds gathered before his eyes.
"What kind of accident?"
Chapter 3. Whitby Park, North Yorkshire, England. Deirdre O'Malley held the fresh sheets to her chest and sent an amused look toward the housekeeper. How much longer could his lordship's sister keep pacing the halls like a caged beast? Lady Ramsay had intercepted Deirdre nearly half an hour past to keep her from carrying out Lord Whitby's command to ready the blue room, but she had yet to decide which one ought to be prepared in its stead. Though Mrs. Doyle pressed her lips tight to suppress a smile, she sent Deirdre a wide-eyed cautionary look.
"The rose room, my lady. Is that one far enough from Lady Regan and Lady Melissa?"
The Marchioness sighed and pressed a hand to her brow.
"It is too far. If we put the girl in there, my brother will know exactly what we're about. I don't want her near my daughters, but we can't put her at the opposite end of the wing."
"It would show her plain as day what we think of her,"
Deirdre murmured into the sheets, though she knew she ought to keep the thought to herself. But her ladyship smiled and let her jet-clad wrist fall to her side again.
"Ah, but my brother is convinced this one is real."
"As he hoped the last three times."
Mrs. Doyle started back toward the end of the hall nearer the stairs.
"We all know how those ended."
That they did, in each pretender being kicked to the drive, and with the Earl becoming more a recluse than ever.
"What about the green room?"
Mrs. Doyle opened a door halfway down the hall. Lady Ramsay peered in.
"It is awfully grand."
The way the housekeeper's spine snapped even straighter than usual would have been more amusing had Deirdre not caught a glimpse of the clock on the chamber's mantle. Her half-day off-duty would begin in another 15 minutes, but she could hardly leave in the middle of a task without getting a scolding. Though if she didn't make it into the village by 2...
"Milady, of course it is grand. They all are. This is Whitby Park, after all." "So I am aware."
Her ladyship chuckled and touched a hand briefly to Mrs. Doyle's arm.
"Very well, then, the green room it is. I will let my brother know I have changed his arrangements."
Much as she liked Lady Ramsay, Deirdre breathed more easily once the lady had gone back down the stairs. She followed Mrs. Doyle into the bedchamber and set the sheets down. When she turned, the older woman was pulling off the coverlet.
"Oh, you needn't trouble yourself, ma'am."
Mrs. Doyle didn't so much as pause. "Nonsense, Deirdre. Beatrix is putting the drawing rooms to rights, and making the bed yourself would take too long. With the Earl's nieces here, you must be back from the village in time for the dressing gong."
"Then I thank you."
She unfolded the first of the sheets and handed one side to the housekeeper.
"He swore after the last one that he wouldn't entertain any more pretenders."
A long sigh accompanied her superior's brisk movements.
"This one comes on the recommendation of Lord Harlow, a future duke. It's hard not to make an exception given that."
She tucked a corner with precision Deirdre had learned from her years ago.
"Wish as we may that his lordship wouldn't have to go through all this again, it is already set. The girl is coming. All we can do now is pray she leaves the Earl's heart intact when she is dismissed."
"Aye."
They worked in silence for a moment, but Deirdre met the woman's eye again when they shook out the top sheet.
"I've always wondered why his lordship didn't just remarry and hope for a son."
A wistful smile settled on Mrs. Doyle's lips.
"You would understand had you seen him with Lady Whitby.
He'll mourn her for the rest of his life."
"I suppose it's never easy losing one spouse." Mrs. Doyle fluffed a pillow and put it in place.
"How is your mother faring these days?"
"Getting on. As best as to be expected anyway. Mum couldn't move past Dar any more than the Earl could his long-gone countess." She helped pull the coverlet back up, smooth it out, position the decorative pillows.
"There we are.
And off you go. Remember, back by the dressing gong."
Not wasting time on anything more than a curtsy and a smile, Deirdre hurried out and up the back stairs, untying her apron as she went. The sparse room she shared with Beatrix was silent and empty, so Deirdre laid the white apron carefully upon her bed and took up her coat, hat, and handbag. Inside the last, she'd already tucked the letters she needed to post. One for Uncle Seamus in India, and another for Mum and her siblings, including the pound notes.
1:30 already. Heavens, she had better hurry.
Praying she didn't meet with Mrs. Doyle or Mr. Graham the butler to be scolded for her too quick step, she flew below stairs and headed for the back door.
"Deirdre, wait! I'll walk with you to the village."
She oughtn't to have to stifle a groan, not over Hiram. And any other day she would welcome the company of the second footman, just not today. Still, she paused a step away from escape. Noise from the kitchen filled her ears, and its sense reminded her that she would miss tea, and she hadn't put aside any of her pay for frivolities like a biscuit from the baker in town. Not this month. It would all head to Kilkeel. Little Molly needed a new coat for the coming winter, Mum had said. Hiram tucked a hat onto his head as he joined her.
"Shall we then?"
"Aye."
Though as soon as they were out in the cool air, she reached up to straighten his hat for him.
"Much better."
He laughed and skewed it again.
"Stop your fussing, Dee. I'm not expected to look as polished as the silver when on my own time in the village."
"Mr. Graham would disagree."
A grin tugged at her lips.
"I don't see him about, do you?"
He checked over each shoulder to be sure, though, as they headed around the drive.
"Safe and free. Have you any big plans this afternoon?"
Her fingers tightened around the frayed strap of her handbag.
"Letters to post, a bit of this and that by way of errands. You?"
"As it happens, my cousin is on his way through the area, and we're grabbing a bite at the pub."
Praise be to heaven, he'd be paying no mind to her then.
"Oh, won't that be a treat for you?"
Aye.
Hiram shot her a grin that faded to a comfortable silence. He took up a whistle as the long drive went round a bend. His ditty proved lighter than the sunshine, flitting in and out of the clouds, warmer than the autumn air. She fussed with her jacket's buttons and tried not to sigh. How did he do it? Stay so bright and cheerful all the time, as if his parents were still alive, as if his brothers hadn't all been scattered, as if he hadn't been passed over for first footman when Mr. Graham's nephew arrived. As if life were fair. But she couldn't recall ever seeing Hiram frown for more than a minute, and they had both been working at Whitby Park for nigh on 7 years now. Made her wonder if there weren't a screw loose somewhere in that pleasant-looking head of his. His whistle came to a halt.
Hold up a moment, Dee. I've a lace untied here.
She let her feet carry her a step farther while he bent down, let her eyes sweep across the moors that had never felt quite like home. Maybe one of these days she'd be able to return to Ireland, settle down with a farmer or merchant who wouldn't mind that her best years had been spent in a lord's house in England, see that Mum passed her later years without working her fingers to the very bone. Assuming she could ever get ahead of the debt Dar had taken on when the crops failed back in 1902. It wouldn't happen on a maid's salary, for sure and certain, though the extra she made as head housemaid certainly helped.
Dee!
The panic in Hiram's tone snapped her back to the present. Hooves thundered, and she had wandered into the crossroads. She hadn't any time to realize where the horses were coming from before she was yanked backward. Her feet tangled with Hiram's, and they both tumbled into the ditch. Pain shot through her bottom as she landed. At the loud whinny directly before her, she looked up to see that the two horses had reined in and one of the riders had dismounted. Hiram muttered something unintelligible and helped her to her feet as the rider strode their way. A mere glance showed her why her friend had been so quick to pull her up. Deirdre dropped into a wobbly curtsy.
Lord Kitten, my apologies.
The young Earl frowned, halted a few steps away.
We are the ones who must apologize for such a careless race. Are you injured?
I am well, my lord.
Deirdre smoothed her grey skirt and directed her gaze to the ground. No doubt Lord Caton wouldn't recognize her from the times he'd come to Whitby Park, but it would take no great logic to realize from where they'd come. And his lordship may decide later it was their fault rather than his.
And you, man?
Hiram cleared his throat.
No worse for the wear, my lord. Leave them to their outing, Caton, and let's be on our way.
The second voice brought Deirdre's gaze up, but only for a moment. A moment was sufficient to reveal the chiseled features and ebon hair that matched the smooth baritone.
Coming, Pratt! You're both certain you are well?
Deirdre nodded along with Hiram as Lord Caton remounted his horse. They held their place until the riders had continued past and then stepped back onto the road toward Eden Dale. Hiram let out a whisper of breath and brushed something from Deirdre's shoulder.
Are you hurt, Dee Dee?
Nothing that hasn't passed already.
She grinned to let him know she meant it.
And you?
Fine.
But he sent a rare frown after the gentleman before he shook himself and smiled again.
We have an adventure to tell now, and some folks claim village life is too quiet.
She had little choice but to laugh. The rest of the walk into town was uneventful, and they parted ways at the pub. Deirdre first posted her letters and then paused outside for a fortifying breath. A look around proved no one paid her any undue mind, so she headed for the church. Silence embraced her inside the sanctuary, and light slanted in with all the colours of the stained glass. It ought to have brought peace, reverence, but instead her pulse picked up as she slid into the next-to-last pew. Only then did she check her watch. 2 minutes to spare. No footstep sounded, but she felt it when he came in, and she held her breath until he slipped into the pew behind her. Held it until, as always, he leaned forward and pressed a kiss to her jaw.
"You nearly frightened me to death back there in the lane."
Her eyes slid shut.
"Nothing frightens you, Lord Pratt."
Least of all the thought of her being harmed.
"You think me such an ogre?"
"I think you too far above me to be disturbed by my stumbling."
She slid away a few inches and turned to see his profile. The first time he had approached her, she had been struck dumb by his beauty. But it was the beauty of a dark angel. That she had learned quickly enough. His chuckle made no pretense of mirth. Much like the fingers he trailed down her neck never pretended they wouldn't as soon strangle as caress.
"Tell me, my lovely Deirdre, how is it you know Lord Caton?"
Though she wanted to swallow, she didn't dare. Those fingers would note it and mark it against her.
He came to Whitby Park with his cousin last month, Lord Harlow, about the girl."
"And is that the only time you've seen him? He hasn't come another time to call on Whitby's nieces."
He lifted a brow, his black gaze promising to know if she lied.
"He came to dine once since, but he seemed more taken with Lady Melissa than Lady Regan."
"Good, good."
Lord Pratt rested his arm on the back of the pew.
"And Lady Regan, of whom has she been speaking lately?"
Not him, though she wished she didn't have to admit that.
"Her preference isn't clear, my lord, though her sister teases her most about Lord Worthing."
No one else she had ever met could pack so much displeasure into a hum.
"You, of course, put in a word wherever you can."
"Of course."
"And Whitby, I heard he succeeded in breaking the entail on the estate."
That at least should appease him.
"Aye, with no possible heir through the paternal lineage, they granted it. The estate will go wherever he wills it, and the title will go extinct when he passes on."
She wasn't sure why so distant a maternal cousin as Pratt had any thought his lordship might name him heir, but then he knew it was unlikely. That was why he was so determined to court Lady Regan. Lord Pratt leaned in until their noses all but touched.
"And where will he will the estate?"
Mr. Graham thinks it certain Lady Regan will inherit, but Lord Whitby never speaks of such things in my presence."
"Of course not."
His smile did nothing to soften the steel in his eyes.
"But he speaks of it to someone, and someone else overhears. Then that someone no doubt bandies it about in the kitchen later. I ask only that you keep your ears open, my sweet."
Her nod was slight, lest it put her face any closer to his.
"I do."
"I know you do. After all, you realize my funds are not unlimited. I cannot keep supporting your family forever. Not without..."
"I know."
She squeezed her eyes shut.
"Unless, of course, you are willing to."
"Please, I understand."
He laughed.
"Very well, my lovely. Cling to your so-called respectability a bit longer."
The crinkling of paper drew her eyes open again, and she saw a banknote dangling before her. Eyes wide, she looked past the note into him.
"Why is it more than we agreed?"
"Incentive."
He reached over the pew back and slid into the handbag she set at her side. There was nothing she could do but say thank you, even though she knew the devil never made a gift without demanding something in return. Chapter 4. Rain pelted the window, and the wind howled about the railway carriage. Brooke pulled her coat tighter and wished for a blanket. Across from her, Justin pressed his lips together, but a smile still winked.
Cold, Brooklet.
Perhaps she ought not to have teased him so mercilessly over the years about his inability to adjust to the Mediterranean heat in the summers. Turnabout was fair play, after all. She crossed her arms and dug up a grin.
It is invigorating.
As he laughed, Brooke looked toward the door at the end of the car. Their companions would be back any moment. His valet, Peters, and her governess-turned-chaperone, Mademoiselle Ragusa. Perhaps Brooke should have requested some coffee to warm her. She decided to settle for a body to block the chill from the window, and so moved to Justin's side. Her book thudded to the floor and he leaned down to pick it up, then laughed again.
Dracula?
Lifting her chin, she snatched it away and set it beside her.
It has a portion that takes place in the town of Whitby. How was I to pass it up?
Though he shook his head, his eyes gleamed. A beautiful sight. For the week they remained in Monaco making arrangements for his father's funeral, he had been so silent she feared he would turn to marble.
Not exactly scientific research on your new hometown, mon ami.
Well, it was the best I could find in the meager 10 minutes you afforded me in the bookshop yesterday.
And the thought of her new home made her every bit as anxious as the red-eyed stranger had made Harker in the first chapter. Justin studied her for a long moment, seeming, as usual, to divine her thoughts from her innocuous words. With a crooked half-smile, he took her hand in his and set the world to rights.
Look, he nodded toward the window.
No new rain pattered the pane, though a few stubborn drops still clung and slipped along. Beyond them, sunshine broke through the clouds and painted the landscape with gold. Brooke drew in a long breath. She had read of the English moors, and Justin had done his best to describe them to her. But nothing had prepared her for the sheer expanse. The land seemed to roll on forever, hardly touched by man. Heather blossomed purple and shone green as far as the eye could see.
It's beautiful, so big, you could fit all of Monaco in that one valley.
It made her itch to find a horse and let it have its head, to fly through the countryside until she lost herself in its grandeur. A new chill swept up her spine. Perhaps she didn't want to lose herself quite yet, not until she knew she had been found.
Another minute and you'll be able to see the North Sea. That should help you feel more at home.
She kept her gaze fastened on the moors, not arguing when he slid closer to the window and pulled her along with him. She drew in a deep breath.
How do you survive in the Cotswolds without an ocean nearby? I don't know that I could do that.
Whenever it becomes unbearable, I simply go to Monaco.
As he said that last word, the mirth faded from his eyes, and his tone went from cheerful to a low throb. His thumb stroked over her knuckle.
I suppose I have no reason to return there now.
Her heart twisted at the pain in his voice.
It has only been a week. Give yourself time to take it in.
Now he gripped her fingers so tightly they pulsed along with the memories. His face contorted for a fraction of a moment before he battled it back into a smooth, handsome mask over the agony.
I tried to warn him. He'd had too much to drink. He ought not to have, but he wouldn't listen.
He would never listen, not about anything.
Covering his hand with her other hand, she prayed the gentle pressure she applied would steady him.
His choices were his own. I know, but I...
He touched his head briefly to hers.
I'm sorry, I shouldn't prattle on about my loss when you've a reunion before you.
Please, prattle. She tried to grin, though it felt unconvincing. For a moment he simply stared at her, the sapphire of his eyes going deeper with contemplation. Then he leaned over and kissed her forehead.
You have nothing to fear, mon ami. They will welcome you.
She longed to believe him, but the heather outside stretched on and on, no civilization in sight. Everywhere she looked was green and soft purple, instead of white and terracotta. Lovely, but not home. What if her family, assuming they were her family, were the same? The breath she drew in quavered. And if not...
His fingers squeezed hers again. Then you pay a visit to the Cotswolds. There is no ocean there, but there will always be a friend.
Yes, better to focus on the unchanging. No matter what, Justin would always be there, even if there was still too far away. Wishing she didn't feel like a lost child, she clung tight to his hand.
But you will stay in Yorkshire a little while, we? At least until we are sure that I... that they...
Until you are well and truly settled.
His smile was his own now, not the shadow it had been the last week.
My cousin Caton has a house an hour's drive from Whitby. I can stay with him as long as necessary.
An hour's drive in Monaco? That would take one into France, most of the way into Italy. Odd how it now kept one within the same neighbourhood. She nodded and directed her gaze to the window again. Just in time. The train crested a little knoll, and there, out in the distance, beckoned the unmistakable sparkle of sun on a placid sea. Slate grey rather than emerald and azure, but that was no matter. It was the ocean, capable of raging and calm, of peace and war, of beauty and destruction. Her lips tugged up. Justin was right. Wherever there was a sea, she could find her place. Mademoiselle Ragusa and Peters returned a moment later, the latter handing a cup of steaming coffee to Justin. The smell brought her to alert, though at the look on Justin's face when he sipped, she couldn't help but laugh.
Not to your liking, my lord.
In some things, I will always be monégasque.
Justin took another drink, but then shook his head and handed the cup back to Peters.
Coffee, if not strong enough to wake a man from a coma, is not truly coffee. Hear, hear.
Brook raised an invisible cup of café espresso in salute. His valet chuckled and settled into his seat across the aisle.
Rest easy, my lord. Soon enough you'll be back at Raylan, where Mrs. Moore knows exactly how you like it, even though no visitor can stand the stuff.
They could be sure at least one visitor would enjoy it when Brooke finally made her way to his home. All her life she had heard his stories of Raylan Castle, of its burgeoning flower gardens and centuries of lore, of the charming Cotswolds region with its thatched roof stone cottages. A fairy tale setting, with Justin as the brave prince atop his stately white horse.
There is Whitby.
Justin nodded toward the window where roofs and chimneys came into view abutting the sea, and atop a hill, a striking, crumbling old church.
And Whitby Abbey there. Your father's home is 10 miles further on. He'll have sent a carriage or a car, I should think, to meet us at the station.
Brooke clasped her hands together to keep them from shaking. The knots tied themselves tighter in her stomach as the train slowed.
We shall call this story the beginning of the Baroness. Justin whispered into her ear as the locomotive screeched to a halt. And it will be heartwarming, if dull for lack of conflict. Perhaps his jest didn't make the knots unravel as she stood, but it at least stilled the churning of her thoughts. Justin and his valet exited first and then reached around to help her and Mademoiselle Ragusa alight. The wind blustered around her the moment her foot touched the platform. Justin chuckled at her shiver.
Too brisk for you?
Brisk? It felt as though snow ought to be swirling. Not that she'd ever experienced that phenomenon.
Not at all. I'm perfectly warm.
Liar.
His laugh rang out warm and hearty, though. And when his gaze moved beyond the platform, his eyes lit still more. He raised an arm in greeting.
Thate, what are you doing here?
Brook followed his gaze toward a man leaning against the hood of a car. Having heard of Justin's closest English friend for years, she expected the unfashionably long hair, the laissez-faire that his folded arms shouted, and the grin that made him look more the piratical rogue than the respectable earl. She'd always thought she'd get on well with the notorious Alexander Thate. Here was a man who knew the benefits of tossing expectation to the wind and embracing one's dreams, who eschewed society's gossip. And who no doubt got away with it because of the good humour in his smile and his handsome face. Mademoiselle Ragusa leaned close.
If these two are an example of the gentleman to be found here, you shall have a fine time, yes?
She whispered in Monegasque. Brooke pressed her lips against a laugh as Thate pushed away from the automobile and jogged forward, hand extended. He and Justin met midway and clasped hands. She came close enough to hear the reply to Justin's question.
I headed this way when I got your wire, and Mother insisted we pay a visit to Lady Ramsay and her daughters at Whitby Park. So, naturally, when Wit said someone must meet your train, I volunteered.
Then the handsome face went taut.
I'm so sorry about your father. Had there been time for me to come? I know.
Again, the leashed pain took hold of Justin's voice.
And with Grandfather too unwell to travel and my aunts afraid to leave him.
His shoulders coming up, he drew in a deep breath.
But enough of sad things.
He beckoned Brooke forward. Thate's eyes went wide as she approached.
Juices, man! Now it all becomes clear!
Brooke looked from Thate to Justin. Did he see a resemblance to the family at Whitby Park, as Justin had insisted? The roll of Justin's eyes made her think it was something else, and that glower of his when his friend turned to her made her wonder what it might be. Thate executed a graceful bow and held out his hand to receive her fingers. Amusement winked in his eyes as he kissed them.
Enchanté, mademoiselle. Lord Thate at your service.
It is a pleasure, my lord. Justin has told me much about you.
She curtsied in return and gave him a warm smile. Thate released her fingers, though the light in his eyes grew only more mischievous.
Likewise, and might I say, you have all the beauty for which the Eden family is famous.
Yet, if she weren't mistaken, the interest gleaming wasn't in her so much as in making Justin's brow furrow still more. No doubt he knew how protective their friend could be, and enjoyed seeing him riled. A grin stole over her lips.
Thank you, my lord.
Justin all but stomped to her side and took her elbows, guiding her past his friend.
Thate, you promised.
The earl tossed his head back in laughter, though Brooke couldn't think what broken promise would be so funny. Then he hurried ahead of them and opened the rear door of the car.
And you, Bing, said she was pretty.
Me? Brooke tilted her head to look up at Justin. He halted a step away from the door, amusement now battling the temper in his eyes, brightening them from indigo back to sapphire. "Did you just call me Bing?"
"Well, I can hardly keep calling you Harry now, O illustrious Marquess of Abingdon."
Brooke gathered up the fabric of her skirt, ready to climb into the car.
"Why did he ever call you Harry? I thought that a nickname for Henry."
"It was his variation on Harlow. Sate has a remarkable knack for coming up with the most ridiculous nicknames for his friends. And," Justin added, pointing a finger at the makeshift chauffeur, "she is pretty."
Sate lifted a single brow.
"And fire is a bit warm."
Again, she got the impression he said it more to irritate Justin than to compliment her, which again made her grin. For a long moment, Justin made no reaction. Then he shook his head and gave in to a smile.
"I ought to have known that having the two of you in the same country would give me nothing but headaches."
"Your own fault for choosing us as friends."
Sate offered Brooke a hand to help her into the car. She settled upon the cushion that faced backward, directly behind the driver's seat, and slid over so that Justin might take the spot beside her. Mademoiselle Ragusa settled opposite, while Peters and their trunks moved to a separate carriage.
"Are we ready, then?"
Sate slid into the front behind the wheel. Justin ran a hand over the trim.
"This isn't one of yours, is it?"
"Whitby's."
"I thought so. Far too sensible for you."
As Sate navigated out of the town, conversation lulled. But once countryside surrounded them, Justin angled himself on the seat. His smile was warm and clear.
"One introduction made already. I dare say you'll meet Caton soon, Brooklet. I have a feeling he will come with me often to visit, at least so long as your cousins are there."
The engine begged for a shift and then protested when Sate ground the gears. Brooke winced. Justin arched his brows and grinned.
"Yes, indeed. You ought to have seen the look in his eyes when he met your cousin. He has probably been haunting Whitby this past month."
Though she couldn't make out much of Thate's face, she saw the muscle tick in his jaw just before he said,
"I dare say if he has tried it, Lady Reagan sent the braggart packing." "I didn't say Lady Reagan was the one who caught his eye."
Justin's grin grew, teasing out creases in his cheeks that couldn't quite be called dimples.
"Though I find it fascinating you would assume so."
"Lady Melissa, then."
The edge left Thate's voice, and his next shift was smooth.
Perhaps she could mold him into a more palatable human being."
Justin's chuckle wove through the wind.
"Do you hear that, Brooklet? For your younger cousin, Caton is worth saving, but for your elder, he ought to be sent packing. Methinks Thate is smitten with Lady Reagan."
"Poppycock!"
Thate turned a bit too sharply around a corner, sending Brooke sliding into Justin.
"And even if I were, it would hardly matter. Everyone knows Lord Worthing will propose soon, and no young lady in her right mind would turn down a future duke."
Justin made an impressed noise.
"I shall keep that in mind, Alex, old friend." "Except for you, of course. Ladies will turn you down by the dozen, what with that ugly mug of yours."
He sent them bouncing over a rut in the road. Brooke slapped a hand to her hat to keep it from flying off in search of a new mistress.
"Will you stop teasing him before he jars us from the car?"
With a laugh, Justin relented and turned the topic to automobiles. The ride smoother now, Brooke settled in and let her gaze wander. The purple sprigged countryside surrounded them, the North Sea in sight again with every crest of a knoll. Fingers at her necklace, she twisted the two dangling pearls together, apart, together, the opposite way. The sun broke through the clouds more fully, though its warmth was minimal, its gilding was unsurpassed. Brook drew in a long breath and watched the gold play over the heath, chasing the cloud's shadows. So beautiful. But could it ever be home? As the car overcame another small hill, the sea sparkled in the spreading sunshine. Justin leaned close.
There it is.
Her breath fisted in her chest, her pulse hammered. She shifted, twisted, let her fingers fall from her necklace and gripped Justin's hand and looked. Whitby Park sprawled across the land, its central building a proud edifice of red-brown brick that seemed nearly as large as her home, the Palais Princier in Monaco. The gardens were more expansive than anything Monacoville could boast. The grandeur she had expected, the beauty she had anticipated, but this tugging in her chest? Of that she didn't know what to make. She couldn't possibly remember anything from her first months of life. Yet, when fate turned the car onto the long drive, she could have sworn something clicked inside her, like a piece of a puzzle finding its place. One part of the picture that might someday reveal who she really was. One small hint that made her wonder all the more at the blank spaces. Chapter 5. From the car, Justin surveyed the rows of people waiting before the grand front entrance to Whitby Park. The family aligned in front and the servants behind. All stood straight as arrows, all looked taut as bows. All wore cold cynicism under masks of welcome. His fingers wanted a fist, but he kept them relaxed so as not to alarm Brooke. If any one of them dared to insult her, dared to upset her, if any one of them showed her anything but kindness, they wouldn't, not so long as he was there. He knew well she had only been granted this audience because Whitby wouldn't turn down the request of the Duke of Stafford's heir. But one audience was surely all it would take. Whitby would see in a glimpse what Justin had upon spotting the painting of the late Lady Whitby. The rest of the family, though? He scanned the faces, most of them vaguely familiar. Lady Ramsay and her elder daughter, Lady Reagan, he had met a time or two during the season, though the younger girl hadn't yet debuted. The matron stood close to her brother, the tilt of her chin giving away the steel behind her gracious smile. Lady Reagan looked nearly bored, as if she had undergone the same scenario countless times. Which, likely, she had. How many pretenders had paraded through Whitby Park, hoping to charm their way into an inheritance? Thate switched off the magneto and slid out of the car, bringing Lady Reagan's smile to the surface. Justin couldn't tell if she had any interest in his friend beyond that which every female seemed to have in society's most dedicated black sheep. But her demeanor shed some light on why Thate was taken with the raven-haired beauty. The true question, though, was whether her loveliness would be soured by hatred when her cousin was legitimized and named heiress in her place. If so, then hopefully Thate would forgive Justin for taking her to task. The younger daughter shifted beside her sister, curiosity colouring her expression as she tried to glimpse the visitors. Whitby himself looked the least at ease. He kept his hands clasped behind his back, but rocked on his heels. No smile curved his lips. His jaw was clenched too tightly. Beside him, Brooke toyed with her necklace. Twist, release, twist again. But it was the only indicator of her anxiety. Her face bore the mask learned first from Colette and then perfected under the Grimaldi tutelage. Did she realize how much the princess she looked? There was no pretending to that kind of bearing, the regal je ne sais quoi that made heads turn whenever she stepped onto the street. Or perhaps heads turned because she was, as Thate so helpfully pointed out, stunning. Not that it gave his friend any excuse to flirt with her, and not that, as he had implied, her beauty had anything to do with why Justin had so long been her friend. He gave her a little nudge toward Thate's outstretched hand. Brook let go of her necklace, drew in a long breath, and met his gaze. Her eyes had always told him more about her thoughts than her words. Right now, they said she hoped, and she feared, and that something in her was beginning to believe. Justin smiled. When Brooke believed in something, there was no stopping her. Out you go, my lady. She leaned toward the door, but then stopped and spun back around, brows creased. Do I have to call you Lord Abingdon?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.